I used to run a single pie-hole instance, and every time I rebooted it, my whole house lost internet access.
Hey, is the internet down?
If you've ever had your whole network go down just because pie-hole rebooted, you can probably relate to this. That's when I realized, why not run multiple pie-holes for redundancy? That way, if one goes offline, the other one keeps everything running without interruption. But running multiple pie-hole instances creates a new problem, keeping them in sync. If one pie-hole has a different block list or DNS entries, things get really messy really fast. After testing some different approaches, I found the best way to automate syncing using a container-based tool called Nebula Sync. Nebula Sync is a service that keeps your primary pie-hole in sync with multiple replicas, so everything stays identical with zero manual work. And since it runs on a container, it will work with Synology, TrueNAS, Unraid, or anything that runs Docker. If you're new to pie-hole, here's the quick version. Pie-hole is a network-wide ad blocker that blocks ads and trackers at the DNS level. Unlike browser extensions that only work on one device, pie-hole blocks ads for your entire network, including phones, smart TVs, and game consoles. It can also detect malicious domains and really gives you full control over DNS filtering. In this video, I'll show you how to set up Nebula Sync to keep your pie-holes perfectly in sync. I'll also cover which features to enable and which ones you might want to disable to avoid any unwanted configuration conflicts. So here's what you'll need to get started. You'll need two pie-hole servers. Now, these can be virtual machines, physical machines, Raspberry Pis, LXC containers, anything really, since Nebula Sync uses the pie-hole API, the hardware and how you're hosting it doesn't matter. You'll also need Docker running somewhere in your environment. This could be on a server, a NAS, or even a dedicated Docker host. And while I'll be using the command line in this tutorial, you don't have to. You can manage everything in a UI or portainer if you prefer. I'll be using Docker Compose to make this setup easier, but as long as you have a Docker engine running somewhere in your environment, you're good to go. And that's it. If you're looking for a full tutorial on setting up pie-hole, Nebula Sync, and Unbound, and possibly even Keep Alive D, check out WonderTech's channel. He's got a great tutorial covering just that. So Nebula Sync is open source and you can find it on GitHub. It's really simple to configure and there are very few options if you go the full automatic route. But I'm going to talk about why you may or may not want to do that when we talk through these options. But it's pretty simple. You have a services stack called Nebula Sync. You point to an image, name the container, and then you have some environment variables. Now, one environment variable you'll need is primary, and this is pointed at your primary pie-hole DNS server. And this variable should be set to your pie-hole website, then with a pipe, and then your password. And then for replicas, you can have any number of replicas, and you kind of do the same thing. You point it at your pie-hole website, you use a pipe with your password, and then use a comma, so it's comma delimited. And then we have our third pie-hole instance here, which again is just the URL with a password divided by a pipe. One thing I will call out here is that you should probably use HTTPS. Now they're saying HTTP, but pie-hole now comes with HTTPS, so you should probably use it. So I'll show you in my example. And there's another setting we need to turn on because we're going to use HTTPS. But then after that, you'll see full sync equals true, run gravity equals true, which is telling it to update your block list every time that this runs, and then a cron job, which this is saying run every hour on the 0 minute every day of every month of every year. So basically hourly. And that's it, unless you want to change a few things. So let's create our compose stack and I'll talk about the things you might want to change. So if I SSH into my Docker server, I'll want to put this stack somewhere where I can run it. Now I've been putting mine in /ops/stacks, and then in here you'll see I have a whole bunch of stacks. So let's create one for Nebula Sync, even though it's just one stack. So I'm going to make a directory called Nebula Sync, and then we'll cd into it. Once we're in here, we'll want to open a text editor and create a file called compose.yaml. And then once I'm in here, I'm going to paste my contents of my Docker Compose, which looks pretty bare. And if we look at it, we just have services, name the service, get an image, name the container, and then use an .env file. So I am going to point at a .env file rather than do it here in YAML. So let me save that really quick, and then let's create our .env file. So I'm going to do a nano.env, and then in here, I'm going to paste my variables. So my primary pie-hole server is 192.168.60.10, and I want to access this over HTTPS. And then you can see I have my pipe here and then my password, and this is my real password. I'll reset it and I'll also show you how to set it here in a little bit. And then I have my replicas, which are three other Pi-hole servers, which you can see just a different IP address with the same password, just a different IP address, same password, just a different IP address and the same password, separated by a comma. Now, setting your password the same on all Pi-hole instances isn't required. I just do it because it's easy and I don't have to try to figure out the passwords for each. You should probably have unique ones, but for me, I'm keeping the same across all and it's pretty secure. Since we have a primary and replicas, your primary is going to be the source of truth. So once we set this up, you'll only want to make changes on your primary, and then all of those changes will replicate to all your replicas. Then I'm setting full sync to false, and we'll talk about this here in a little bit. And then I may as well hop to cron because that will explain why I keep run gravity to false. And for my cron timer, I'm saying run every 15 minutes. Now, 99.999% of the time, that's too often. But there are times when I add additional records or make changes when I'm writing code or doing something where I need that record to update, you know, within 15 minutes. And so what I've always done is just create the record, set up my environment, do other things. And by the time I get back to it within 15 minutes, I know that the record's going to be there. So this is pretty often. You might be fine with hourly, which is what they recommend. I found 15 minutes works good for me. And because I'm doing it every 15 minutes, I don't want to update gravity every 15 minutes. So that's going to pull down all of my 20 or so block lists and update my database every 15 minutes if I had this on. And then it's going to do that for all four of my instances. I figured I don't want that much churn on all of my servers. So then I set this to false, which means it will fall back to the Pi-hole default, which I think is once a week on Sunday. But tune this to your needs. These are just my needs. The next variable, client skip TLS verification equals true, is what I need to turn on in order to synchronize over HTTPS with a self-signed certificate. Now, this is self-signed and it's provided by Pi-hole. And if you try to sync without this turned on, it'll fail because it doesn't trust the certificate. So what I found is I need to turn this on. Now, do you need to turn it on if you're going through a reverse proxy that has a trusted certificate? No. Do you need to turn it on if you've used Let's Encrypt on your Pi-hole instance and you have a trusted certificate? No. Should I keep going? Do you need to turn this on if you've generated a certificate on your Pi-hole instance and then trusted that certificate on this machine where this is running? No. So there are lots of reasons why you may or may not want to turn this on, but if you're using a self-signed one, you're going to have to make it true so that it will skip the verification. Next is time zone. That might not seem obvious, but the logs are written out in universal time. If your server's in universal time, then it'll make sense to keep these container logs in universal time. But my servers aren't in universal time, probably should be, but mine are in my local time zone. And so setting the time zone on this container will make sure that when I look at the logs, they make sense. Next is an explanation of why I don't use full sync. So I set full sync to false, and that's because I want to have a little more control over all of these configurations. And also, full sync isn't deterministic, I guess is the best way to put it. It's non-deterministic, meaning that full sync today means one thing, and full sync tomorrow, next week, or the next time they make a change could mean another. And I don't want any surprises like that. So even if I were going to set full sync to false, and use all of these, I would set all of those to true. Now, that's probably just the developer in me, and it doesn't matter. Full sync is probably fine for you, and you don't need to worry about if it's deterministic or not. But I like a little bit more control over it, and I don't want to synchronize everything. And so if they ever add an additional option and add that to full sync, it's guaranteed that I'll never adopt that option because I don't have full sync to be true. It's going a little far, but this is kind of how my brain works. But anyways, I don't want to sync everything anyways. So I only want to sync DNS configuration. I don't want to sync DHCP because I don't use it. I don't want to sync NTP because I actually have these in different environments and one has a different NTP server than the other. Don't want to sync Revolvers, Database, MISC, or Debug. So really, I don't want to sync any core configuration of the Pi-hole server itself. I really just want to synchronize records. Now, if you're doing DHCP, you probably want to synchronize those, but at the same time, you don't want to turn on DHCP on multiple servers, so you'll kind of have to think through that too. But I found I just want to sync DNS, I just want to sync records, and I just want to synchronize my add lists. And so I've made everything false except for DNS configuration, add lists and groups, and then domain lists and groups. And that's really all I need out of this to synchronize. And you might have different needs, so feel free to change this as you see fit, but I found this is exactly what I need and it's just enough and nothing more. So let's save this out and then go back to our folder. Now we want to spin this container up. There's a couple of ways you can spin it up, but while you're testing, I would just run a Docker compose up and then we'll see this running in interactive mode. Now later we'll set it to a daemon mode, so it'll run in the background and run with startup. But while we're debugging, I would just run it in interactive mode. And so we can see the logs here, and you could see those are in my local time. That's how I realized that unless you set the time zone, they're going to be in universal time. But you can see it automatically synced right away. Started Nebula Sync. It ran a sync in selective mode because I didn't do full to three replicas, authenticating, sync teleporters, sync configs, validating session, and sync complete. So it's synchronized already. Cool, so let's test it. So let's actually kill this process, Command-C. Then let's edit our .env file. And then I wanna change this cron to more often because 15 minutes is a long time to wait to test. So I actually wanna do this. Every minute of every hour of every day of every month of every year. I think that's how that works. So this means minute, every minute. But that's what you need to set if you wanna test this out and do every minute. So let's save this. Let's go back, let's start it up again, Docker compose up, let's run it interactively. It synchronizes right away, and then we should see within a minute, it's going to synchronize again. There it goes, it's synchronized again. Now, while this is synchronizing in the background, let's test this out by adding some records. So in my primary pi hole, remember, that's the source of truth, we'll wanna go in here and let's create some DNS records. So if we go into settings, I always forget where this is. I feel like it shouldn't be in settings. I feel like it should be, I don't know, kind of top level. Anyways, that's neither here nor there. Go into DNS records, and in here we can create a DNS record. So let's create a test DNS record really quick. Let's just say example.com, and the IP address is, it doesn't really matter. Let's go Cloudflare DNS. Okay, and let's add that record. And then while we're here, let's just add a CNAME too so we can test this. And so a CNAME is really a way to point at a DNS record. Where a DNS record points at an IP address, a CNAME points at a DNS record. And that's super handy if you're running something like a reverse proxy, right? You would point a DNS record to the IP address of that reverse proxy, and then you would create CNAMEs for all of your websites or all of your domains, and then you would point them at that DNS record. Which is pretty nice because if your IP address of your web server ever changes, you just have to change it there and then you'll know that those CNAMEs still point to a DNS record and you won't have to change anything else. Maybe a little bit too advanced, but I use them quite a bit. So let's create one here. I'm just gonna call it tim.example.com and it's going to point at example.com. Add that. Okay, now we just wait for this to synchronize again. It just synchronized again. Now let's go to one of our replicas. If I go into my secondary DNS and I go into settings and I go into local DNS records, and then we filter on example, you can see here I have the DNS record pointing to the IP address of 1.1.1.1. So let's do the same thing for CNAME. And if we filter on example, you can see here I have my CNAME now that's pointing to that DNS record. So now that we know it can create records, let's see if we can delete them too. So let's go back to our first pi hole instance. Remember, this is my primary. Let's find that record. And then let's delete the CNAME. And then let's delete the DNS record. Now let's let this synchronize again. There it goes, it just synchronized. And then on one of our replicas, if we type an example for DNS records, we don't see it. And then on CNAMEs, we don't see it either. So now it's cleaning stuff up as well. Now that we have this set, let's kill this interactive process that's running. Remember to change your cron job. So I'm doing mine every 15 minutes. And then if we want to start this as a daemon, we can by doing Docker compose up dash D. And so this will run it. And now it's running in the background. If we do a Docker PS and grep for Nebula, we should see it running here. It started 8 seconds ago. If we want to see the logs for that, we can do a Docker logs Nebula Sync, and I'm going to do follow. And then we can see them, and it's going to tail all the logs. If you didn't want to follow and just see the last ones or all of them, you could go to sync and do that. And by running it as a daemon, it'll start with your machine every time it starts up. And remember that not only did I configure it for DNS records, I also created it for add lists. And you can see I have a lot of add lists here. If you noticed earlier, I have over 2 million domains on my add list. That's quite a bit. And if we look at my list, I have quite a bit of them. I get a lot of them from Firebog, which is a great site to get lists to block malware and trackers and other things like that. Green ones are usually okay to use. Blue ones, I found that you might not be able to use some things, even with the green ones. Sometimes there's false positives or ones you need to actually use a website. So kind of hit or miss. I have a pretty good list. I'll post the list that I use in my documentation and you can find that below. But Firebog is really great to kind of experiment with some of these, but get ready for some pain if you enable too many. So that's it. Now I have 4 Pi-hole instances that I keep in sync. I have my primary and 3 replicas. And anytime I make a change on the primary, I know that it will synchronize down to the replicas within 15 minutes, which is also a good point too. Any change you make now, you'll want to do on the primary and then just treat the other ones as read only. And honestly, you never have to go to any of your replicas again, since the primary is where you'll make the changes and that will synchronize down. Pi-hole is such a great utility. I love running it at home. If there's anything else you want to know about Pi-hole, let me know in the comments below. I'm Tim. Thanks for watching.